changes. That which seemed fast to our parents seems slow to us. Both young and old have suddenly ended up in a digital society. How do we ensure everyone can reap the benefits of these new possibilities? How do we keep trust as the foundation of our society? How do we deal with dialogue and decision-making? And how do we use data responsibly? How can technology support us in living a longer and safer life? How do we ensure the constant learning and education of both young and old, very young and very old? What can we do to prepare businesses and employees for a completely new economy? How do we keep urban and rural areas attractive? How can we protect ourselves, our personal data, our freedom? These dilemmas require well thought out solutions for the long term. Life in a digital world, everyone has to deal with it, every cell of society. Because of this, all Dutch universities have now joined forces to generate momentum, to find answers to questions that impact us all. Starting with data, but where people take center stage. This is how we provide extra fuel for innovation with our interdisciplinary academic commitment. We, the Universities of the Netherlands, aim to take the lead in digitalization, together with partners in business, government, and society, to use these rapidly evolving digital possibilities to create a better world.
Beautiful clip. Good afternoon. Welcome to the first ever Digital Society Conference. This will be an important day in history, and congratulations, you are all part of that. Later, the world will speak about the time before the first Digital Society Conference and a time after the Digital Society Conference. And I'm very proud of you all to be part of that here today. My name is Gerrit Heikoop. I'm a professional conference moderator, and I'm here today to increase the impact of this meeting and to keep you all healthy and safe and well throughout the afternoon. Let's start with safety real quickly. For some of you who've never been to this beautiful venue before, look around you. Right next to the stage, there's two emergency exits in case we need to evacuate. At the back on, of the room, left and right, there's one as well, and we assemble across the street in the grass field in case that needs to happen. Another thing about well-being, can I see a quick raise of hands? How many of you have a mobile phone with an internet connection with them? Yes, this is always also a good check of the audio system. Sir, you don't have your mobile phone with you? In the back row? You understand me? Yes, okay. Checking. All right. Obviously, mobile phone and internet connection. We're all connected permanently and have a challenge. Because you might not be aware of it, but a conference like this is one of the most powerful ways of communication. It's the power of face-to-face, of meeting people in real life. It's also a very expensive way of communicating in terms of the budget to put this all together, but also the budget of your time and hours and travel to come here together. So, I want to do an experiment. Who's up for an experiment? Yeah? Good. Let's see if we can make a conference on the digital society 100% analog. So I invite you, / I challenge you, to take your phone, put it in airplane mode, and don't touch it till the rest of the afternoon before you leave. As I personally believe, being offline is a new luxury item, and I all want to give you the present of being offline for 4 or 5 hours. And those of you who feel that you work in an organization that cannot survive without you not responding for 4 or 5 hours to an email or a phone call, draw your own conclusions about that. So, let's try to be really present, be present with the lecture, be present with the workshops, and be present with the people who we have in the room. Because when will this first Digital Society Conference be a success? Well, I've made some bullets for you. I thought then you might understand that. 3 key objectives of today. And you should check yourself throughout the day when you're achieving these goals. First one, I don't want you to leave without fully knowing what the digital society, and more specifically the digital society research agenda, actually is. Secondly, I don't want you to leave without understanding how you can or would like to contribute to this movement, as Emil calls it. If you decide that you don't want to contribute, at least you should be able to explain to others how they can or should contribute. And the third one, and that's why it's so important to keep those phones in your pocket this afternoon, is let's make new connections to actually start making this happen. Are you up for that? All right, it's a shared responsibility with all of us. So let's explore first Digital Society Conference. Who do we have in the room? Can I see a quick raise of hands? Who is sitting next to a person they already know? Be honest. All right, that's about 80% of the room. Not a good start. Predictable, but that's something we should get rid of throughout the afternoon, right? Well, actually, you should get to know more people, but let's see if we can make new connections. This society tries to gather the academics who started the digital society movement, people from government, people from business. So let's quickly do a stand-up count. Can all the people who are here who work at an academic organization, scientists, PhDs, or related, could you please stand up? All right. Good. Yes, thank you. Yeah. So what do we say? It's about 60%. So I say this conference is succeeding, that we have at least 40% outsiders. Thank you. Let's explore who we have. Can all the people who work in a government-related environment, either directly at government, ministries, municipalities, but also police, national library, I saw on the list, who is in a non-profit or government-related organization? All right. Thank you. Welcome all. Thank you for being with us. And who is here from a more corporate background, either large corporations or small corporations, whatever, corporate world, can you stand up? All right, thank you. You are our spearheads into the corporate community. Thank you very much, thank you for being here. All right, let's start with the second challenge. Let's get this over with. Let's try to make a new connection in the first 10 minutes of this conference. So I have a little assignment for you. I want you to meet one new person in the next 2-3 minutes, so I want you to make a pair. Now be diligent about this, don't go in trios or quartets, because then you don't have enough speaking times. One pair, preferably someone you don't know yet, 3 questions. You have 2 minutes, so that's about 1 minute each, right? Take turns, divide equally. The 3 questions that I want you to discuss while standing up is, how did you get here? Maybe by train. No, how did you end up in this room? What do you have to have happened this afternoon, and what do you bring that others in this room might benefit from, right? It's a challenge, so I want you to get up, form a pair, 3 questions in 2 minutes. Go ahead. All right. Ladies and gentlemen, can you raise your hands if you can hear me? Can you raise your hands if you can hear me? Please raise your hands if you can hear me. Yes, yes, keep it up. Can you raise your hands if you can hear me? Yes, raise your hands if you can hear me. Yes, yes, almost there. Keep them up, keep them up. Also in the back, can you raise your hands if you can hear me? Yeah, please have a seat. Thank you. Oh, it's a rogue bunch. All right, that's 2 minutes if you're having fun. Time flies. All right, well done. If anywhere during the course of the afternoon, I'm give you a little exercise and I then ask you, you raise your hands if you can hear me. If you hear that, please do that as quickly as possible. If you see other people raising their hands, then that's a sign that something needs to happen. We have some more cues today. Obviously, we're in a real way environment. Ronald, are you stand by? If ever during the afternoon you hear this sound, it's an indication that you need to move. Either you come to the plenary, you end the workshop, you have a break, whatever. That's our cue to keep ourselves on time. Quick check. Who has just spoken to a nice person? Look at that. Look around. Look around. Look around. 100%. Isn't that amazing? Scientifically, I mean. You invite a bunch of people and you only have nice people here together. Well, beautiful. So now you know, you've just made that awkward step to meeting a new person, and we've just established by our group power that we only have nice people here. So I invite you all to keep that up throughout the afternoon. If ever you feel that you're waiting, don't go on the phone, but actually step into someone who you don't know yet, and you can ask him, how did you get here? What do you hope to have happen? Or what do you bring that others can benefit from? Great icebreakers, and I hope that truly creates some new connections in this Congress. So, let's work a bit on our first objective. Let's understand what the digital society actually is. And to do that, I would like to invite on stage three important team members. It's a much bigger team who is behind this all, but I want you to give a big round of applause for Emil Aerts, the Rector Magnificus of the University of Tilburg, Arthur Mol, the Rector Magnificus of the University of Wageningen, and Ina Lagendijk, Program Coordinator for the Digital Society. Give them a big round of applause. Here's a picture in the back of all the other people involved, and there's probably even more. Emil, welcome. Congratulations on this beautiful turnout.
Yes.
So let's work on that first objective. If you had to explain in a few short words what this digital society is, a movement, you said earlier today.
Yes, it is.
How would you explain it?
That's how we call it. So it's a movement, as you all know, is something that is driven from the spirit. And the spirit comes from the observation that ubiquitous communication, artificial intelligence, big data, they are going to change the world. And the change is disruptive, and it will happen in society. So the universities took up the obligation and responsibility to serve the purpose of being the laboratory of society. So here you have to start working on disruption. And well, you know the outcome. It is a movement, 14 universities, 7 teams. We are going to turn this into a success.
And Emil, why would you say is it so important that the university do this together? Because they can all say, well, we are a laboratory for society in our own means. What is the power of this joining of universities?
Well, the classical answer is we can do it. The more that's contemporary answer is that the universities have a unique position to do it because of the interdisciplinary knowledge that we have. So we can make the connections. You alluded to that already. And the connections are also very important, because the problems that we are faced with in turning the society into a digital one that is better than the one that we have now calls for input from very, very many different disciplines in a concerted action. So the unique thing here is that the 14 universities do this together, and we know it is unique because it never happened in history in the Netherlands before.
Exactly.
And the second part is that we already are approached from other countries with the question, How can this work? And the answer is from the interdisciplinarity. So we are a small country, so the distances are not very long. So we can make these connections. And what I have to mention also is that it is a bottom-up activity. So all the professors are here, not for the money.
Yeah, the program is not backed by a big bag of money.
They are not here for the money. They are here for
something. Why are they here?
Well, I just asked Lisa. Yeah, I only asked. And I checked even. So there is a small scientific approach to it, at least empirically. And she told me that this group of professors leading this initiative, they are the ones that really can turn this into a success. And not being here means that you are not part of the winning team. And not being part,
congratulations, you're doing
and
well.
Not being part of a winning team is for a professor something that makes turns his life into a disaster.
A disaster. Thank you. Yes, all right, Emil.
So this is what makes us tick.
Exactly. Now let's understand, because this initiative was taken 2 years ago. Last year you launched 7 program names. Why are we here today? What does this event mean in this context?
Well, this event, why we are here, I think, is unique, because we have been working for more than a year on it, but we have never actually come together, as you said, face to face with all the 7 teams, and not only with the teams from the university, with the professors, the PhDs, the postdocs, etc., but also with people outside of the university. And I think that's vital. I think, with as Emil said, this is crucial to be engaged in the digital society from a research point of view, but of course also from a society, it's the digital society, from a societal point of view. And we can only do that bringing our knowledge, our research, together with societal stakeholders, with people from industry, from people from government, NGOs, together to make really an impact in society and to understand better what does this digital revolution mean from society. The World Economic Forum this year already coined the fourth industrial revolution, the digital revolution. Well, I don't think it's just an industrial revolution. It's, of course, much broader. So that's also why I think it's very well chosen to be the digital society, and that we are here basically with society. Well, society is a little bit broader than this audience.
It means you're important ambassadors to take what happens here today to the outside world.
Exactly. Yeah, I think so. We need, of course, from here, it's the first step to widen out. And I think that needs to be further enhanced.
Beautiful, thank you. Now, Inald, you're one of the program coordinators. Can you elaborate a little bit on how does this program try to reach these objectives?
Yes, so to stay in the same comparison as Emil just said, we have a soccer team here, but a soccer team also need a coach. And in order to win, you need to do the right thing. So that is basically what we as coordinators are thinking about. And the challenges that we have, of course, are enormous. The digital society puts society question central, but we also want to do this in a responsible way, making use of digital means. And as already was said, we need to do this in an interdisciplinary fashion. So doing this is important, and we can talk for a very long time about this. But the question is, how are we going to do this? And I think it's important to realize that each of us approaches this, you know, challenge from his or her own perspective. If you're in engineering, you see digital society as engineering artifacts, technical artifacts. If you're in humanities or social sciences, you're more, let's say, accustomed to reflection on what are the changes that our society going through. The challenge that we have here is to bring all this together. And the way to do this, that we believe as coaches of this big team, is to find those questions, to carve out those questions that are complex, that do require engineering, technical progression, but also reflections from humanities, social sciences, democratic principles, etc. So it's that search that that we put as an answer to the how question. And obviously, this meeting and today's workshops are an important step for us to realize that. So I would like to answer the question, how do we do this? Well, this way is the way we do it.
All right. Thank you very much. Give them a big round of applause. The team. In that sense, this is a bit of an atypical conference, right? Especially if you're from the academic field. Normally, in an academic conference, you present results. Well, definitely there's results presented here. Outside, you've seen the exhibits of the tangible projects going on. But mainly, this is also about carving out the questions, as you phrase it, Inald. And I think that is an attitude that I invite you all to take this afternoon. Now, in an opening plenary, it would be wise to kind of start off with a common understanding of what this digital society term actually means, what challenges it poses, and wouldn't it be the ideal situation if there would be a professor in media and digital society? Well, I can tell you there is such a position, and I'm very proud to have her with us here today. Give her a big round of applause. José van Dijk, Distinguished Professor of Media and Digital Society at the University of Utrecht. José.
Thank you. All right. Well, thank you very much for being here, and I'm really surprised that there's so many people from different backgrounds, so I hope I can cater to all of your interests. I'll introduce you to a few topics that I've been concerned with over the past few years. And I've chosen this title, Governing Public Values in Digital Societies. I think public values is something that we can all relate to. I happen to have published the second book about that just this week, just came out. And actually, we wrote a first Dutch version of the book, The Platform Society, 2 years ago. It was published by Amsterdam University Press. This one has just come out. This is my team, by the way. I always want to give, acknowledge my teamwork. And what happened between those two books is actually quite surprising. Well, for you, by now, you know all of the problems that we have seen over the past few years. We have been coping with disinformation and fake news. We have looked into, election intervention by big tech corporations. We have been dealing with hate speech and trolling. We've been involved, we've been facing security leaks. We, privacy scandals over the past 2 years have been, tremendously impact our trust in the digital society. Tax evasion, there have been issues with undermining labor laws, etc., etc. I'm not saying that we suddenly, all of a sudden, we can't trust the digital society anymore. The issue of trust is very important, particularly the issue of how do we implement social public values in that digital society. So this is the question that I chosen for today that I would like to, I can't answer this question. How can we anchor public values in open digital societies in Europe? It's a very important question to ask. So, I hope that there's some of these issues that I'll be talking about that you will take that to heart and at least, gives you something to chew on, to reflect. Over the next 20 minutes or so, I would like to talk a little bit more about platform ecosystems that have, are very, very important in our world, in our online world. I would like to concentrate on public values and especially responsible actors that are, taking charge of those public values. And then, of course, my second part will be about what we're doing in this conference and what are the challenges for research. So let's just face, how we're currently standing in this online world where we're basically governed by two platform, what I call platform ecosystems. On the one hand, there's China, and China has its own ecosystem that governs public values in that part of the world. The Chinese ecosystem is governed by its own big five, as you probably know. We have Alibaba, we have Tencent, Baidu, JingoDongMall, and Didi, which is basically the Chinese Uber. We call that the BAT system, in short. Now, I could talk for probably 2 hours, and I would like then Martin to join me because he knows a lot about this Chinese system, but I won't do that for today. I would like, most of us are on a daily basis are dealing more with the American ecosystem, which also consists of five big tech companies, which usually go by the name of GAFAM, Google Alphabet, Facebook, Amazon, Apple, and Microsoft. And they basically dominate the rest of the world. So that is the system that I would like to, talk a little bit more about. Those two ecosystems that govern the world, at first sight, very, very different. For instance, in the Chinese system, data are owned by governments. In the American system, by corporations. There are many differences between those systems, but there are also a lot of similarities. I could at least a full hour lecture on the similarities and the difference, which I won't do today. First, I'm going to give you some idea what I won't do. But but squeezed in between those two ecosystems in the world, we have Europe. And what is so specific about Europe? Well, you know, we don't have many big tech corporations that are responsible, that are taking care of that ecosystem in which architecture those values are cemented. So European society mostly favor what we call a Rhineland model of governing economic and democratic welfare states. And of course, European societies have substantial public sectors. They care a lot about the common good in those public sectors. So squeezed in between those two systems, we are responsible for governing a digital society, which infrastructure is, you know, owned and operated by two systems that we don't have much to say about. So that is one of the issues that needs to be addressed. Mostly, you know, the American system, which I will zoom into, is valued by more or less commercial values. Now, how does that work? And this is a part that I will just gloss over. You can read it, you know, in the book, and I've given many talks, some of which you can see on the internet, so I will, you know, not really dwell on this. But these are these big five players, and of course, they have a lot of market power, they have a lot of market value. They're basically the world's fifth largest economy after the US, China, Japan, and Germany. But for me, more than market value, what is important is that they have societal impact. And that is the kind of impact that you will see, you know, because they act more and more as gatekeepers to our entire, you know, digital economy and our digital society. So what we have seen, this is part of the book which, you know, my colleagues and I have been researching. The big five operate strategic infrastructural platforms. And by infrastructural platforms, we can discuss, you know, about the precise definition of this, but you probably all know that they're operating social networks, think Facebook, web hosting, pay systems, identification services, cloud services, advertising services, search engines, operating system, messaging, navigation, maps, app stores, analytics service, et cetera, et cetera. We have inventorized some 100 of those infrastructural platforms that are connected to those big five. There's hardly any public infrastructure in this, you know, in this platform ecosystem. So we really need to debate as to how public values are anchored if the architecture of that system is basically defined by commercial companies and, you know, public values are constantly coming into play. So what we've been looking at for the book is we've been looking at four particular sectors, two private sectors, two mainly public sectors. We've been looking at urban transport and news as private sectors, and education and health. And what you see in these circles is you see the big infrastructural platforms in the middle, and we've been looking at how the in four sectors, the impact of how they're branching out in the various sectors. Most, you know, platformization doesn't just affect those four sectors, it basically affects all sectors in society, whether it's finance or hospitality or food or, you know, you name it, practically each of those sectors has to deal with the influence of platforms and with digitization. Now, what is really important that, you know, we need to look into is how there's data flows run, not just between those infrastructural sectors, platforms, but also between the various sectors. The data flows that are combined in the back end of systems, of course, define how we, you know, how our digital society is governed, how it is run. So, you know, there's an endless potential for combining data flows and algorithmic knowledge. If you look at this map, for instance, you see that, just one example, but Google currently operates search, advertising, maps, etc., you know, all the platforms that I just showed, but also in various sectors, for instance, in transport, it has, you know, a stake in Uber, which uses Google Maps. In education, you may not know, but Google Apps for Education is becoming increasingly important in how our school systems are governed. In health, Google Fit and Google, you know, for instance, 23andMe is owned by Google. So in all of these sectors, we're seeing that platforms and digitization is, you know, playing an increasingly big role. Just to give you an example, but in education, I got that from the news over the past 6 months, probably. But this is an example of how these systems branch out in various, in this case, public sectors. Amazon is building schools where the child is the customer, as you can read here. Facebook is currently building a system of summit schools. They're experimenting with their own chain of schools and particularly with systems that they can implement in schools. And here is another example from, you know, the past year, how Google is, this is from the New York Times, how Google is taking over the classroom. Now, of course, you know, if you, you know, bring Google laptops into the classroom, it comes with built-in apps, like, you know, Google Apps for Education with, you know, some, you know, 10 or 12 Google apps. And ingrained in the architecture of these platforms are, of course, public values or values that children deal with and that, you know, we have to know. Sometimes schools do know, are very well aware of how these systems work, but sometimes they're not so conscious of what kind of public values are built into this system. Just think about how, for instance, the GDPR, of course, comes with a number of privacy rules, whether that has been built into the system and whether it can be used in schools. Now, in Europe, of course, education is mostly a common good. So what we're looking into is systems that bring in values inscribed into their architecture, but we're dealing with systems in environments like, for instance, in public schools, where there's very little knowledge about how these systems work and how they work in terms of implementing those public values. So let's talk about public values. When we discuss public values, what does that mean? There's a few values that most of you, all of you, are probably familiar with. And those are values like security, transparency, accuracy, and privacy. You know, we need privacy, we need accuracy in order to trust these systems, right? Now, public values are not sort of, you know, fixed values that you can buy off the shelf. You just go, you know, if that were only true, you just go to a store and buy some and implement them into your system. Values are something that constantly needs to be negotiated. And that negotiation happens at every single level in society, from individual schools to all the way to the European Parliament. And that is the kind of negotiation that, you know, we all are involved in. And I think many of you, whether you come from, you know, public governments or from municipalities, that's the kind of negotiation that many of us are dealing with. And, you know, oftentimes these values do not agree. You know, privacy of individuals may sit in short tension with the security of systems. And of course they need to be reconciled. But at every single level, there's a different type of negotiation going on between what values are involved in, you know, implementing those systems in, for instance, schools. Schools want to track children's progress. At the same time, they need privacy for the children. And at the same, very same time, they need to think about whether these systems are a fair representation of, you know, of children's progress. But beyond these pertinent, you know, more individual consumer kind of public values, we have a number of more democratic values, values that pertain to society as a whole. And then we're talking about values like fairness, inclusiveness, responsibility, accountability, and of course, democratic control. Now, single schools or hostels or municipalities, they often deal with, you know, they're buying software packages or they buy software system or data systems with built-in values that they sometimes either don't know much about, or they have to use that as input for negotiations about those public values. Questions like, how can we track fairness, you know, in algorithmic tracking of schools, of children in schools? How can we open up algorithmic processes for democratic control? You know, very important with, you know, all the events with fake news and misinformation that we've been happening. How can we open up news for, you know, in terms of negotiation about those public values of fairness? Who is responsible really for inaccuracies in data flows? Can we actually detect that and take care of those inaccuracies? How can we hold institutions accountable for algorithmic decision making? It's something that we all are learning how to deal with. And, you know, systems are usually not something that are ready-made, ready to be implemented in whatever institutional context. That is part of the negotiation that we're all dealing with. Now, who is responsible? Who are the responsible actors for, you know, implementing, negotiating these public values in societies? This is sort of a lesson that I got from, you know, it's probably Political Science 101, which I never took, by the way, but I always find it very, you know, very clear to get a very simple answer. We are all involved, we're all responsible for the, you know, negotiating public values in a digital society. But of course, it's important to distinguish between three types of actors in that negotiation process: market, state, and civil society. Now, you see here, you know, a lot of stakeholders, which I think they all play a role in that. And particularly, I think it's so typical for European kind of, you know, democratic governments is, whereas, for instance, data belong to corporations in the American system, whereas the state is very much in control of data flows in the Chinese system. What is so typical about Europe is, of course, that we're used to having, you know, democratic society governments which are using multi-stakeholder organizations as the basis for democratic decision making. So all of these actors are, you know, involved in what we call multiple stakeholder negotiations. And I think that's exactly why we are here today. This is sort of the ultimate multi-stakeholder organization negotiation. Researchers, I think, play an extremely important role in connecting these three players, particularly because we as researchers, I myself a researcher, because we can help glue those different parties together. And that's why I think it is so important that we're here today. And these, you know, are a few challenges for research that I think, you know, may be discussed this afternoon in the various sessions that you will be visiting to. But first of all, I would like to underline what, you know, was just said by the three gentlemen here on the stage. I think it is incredibly unique, it's incredibly important that all of the 14 Dutch universities are collaborating on this one specific, enormously complex challenge, which is, how do we govern the digital society? How can we do that responsibly? And there are many, many challenges. There will be, you know, many breakout sessions this afternoon, but I want to mention just a few, just three actually. First, I think it's tremendously important that we're here from all ilks, from all different kind of, you know, disciplinary efforts. This is a huge interdisciplinary experiment, also for us as researchers. We were very safe in our own cubicles, in our own filter bubbles, as, you know, disciplinary experts. But now we're going to work together with people whose expertise we cannot really judge. We have to trust each other in order to bring that knowledge further. And that's why I think it's so important that the digital society, as a collaborative effort, has decided to choose seven teams. And here you see the seven teams that they have decided to focus on, which is citizenship and democracy, work and organizations, health and well-being, responsible data science, safety and security, learning and education, and digital cities and communities. researchers that are really want to show that we can work with the different stakeholders in this country, in these communities, that because we're together responsible for designing, working with, you know, various new technologies. Secondly, I think what we can also do is to help develop value-centric principles for design and, you know, of digital services, of digital practices. And now I know, you know, whenever you mention example, there are 100 more. And I'm so glad there will be, you know, demonstrations of 100 more examples this afternoon. But I just decided to pick a few. There's this one example. At the national and local government level, we're currently struggling to find the best way to design systems for identification, e-identification, and authentication in order, you know, to use your electronic identification on the internet. It's very important in terms of safety, also in terms of, you know, democratic involvement. And this system should be based primarily on public values. That is very important as, you know, infrastructural service. So negotiating public values means that it's not just security and privacy, but we also need to engage citizens. We need to give them more control over their own data. So if you take that as a point of departure, how can you design systems? And that is something that, you know, we're interested in helping the various stakeholders with. Here, for instance, this was a, can you read this? Yeah. It's a position paper by the organization, I don't know what the VNG translates into, but it's the Collaborative Municipalities of the Netherlands, more or less. And they have, this is actually a very interesting paper. They want to design a system for digital identity that is both, you know, has all those public values of security and privacy, gives citizens control over their data, but it's a very complicated issue. And they have been, you know, they have been laying out the various systems that are possible. I know the group from Nijmegen, who's here from Nijmegen, the group with Bart, okay. They've been helping out with this problem by designing a system. I reveal my attributes. Irma just last week won a big prize for, you know, helping with this problem. So I thought it was a good example to take this. But it's trying to design a secure, decentral identification system that lets citizens control whom they show attributes to. So whenever you come in a certain context, you will just have to show the attributes that are required at that particular context. And you do not have to do that in another context. If you come to a bar, you just have to show that you're over 18. You don't have to reveal, you know, whoever is in your filter bubble or whatever or whatever. So this is a system that helps negotiate more or less what public values are and how you can turn them into a type of design. Thirdly, and you know, I could list like another 10 of those, but I think what we could do as researchers is to help articulate value-driven principles for digital or data-driven, as I call it, practices and policies. Now, this is a huge challenge, and you know, it's actually very important that we help institutions to take certain decisions and help them negotiate in order to make sure that will be done democratically. For instance, in schools, you know, how we can help them to decide how can we make algorithmic tracking systems not only secure and safe, but also make them fair, make them transparent, and yet protect the privacy of children in school, right? That's a huge challenge, but I think there's a number of people here who are interested in solving that particular problem. Take, you know, the same problem for hospitals. How can data-driven approach help both personalized medicine and yet balance off the privacy of the data of patient data? And something that I personally am involved in is, of course, to work with public and private media. How can we provide accurate and balanced information while at the same time filtering out hate speech and offering citizens democratic control over the information that they get? So with each of those institutions, I think, and those are just, you know, a few of those teams, if we develop that sort of knowledge, we can also, that also leads us as researchers to more overarching questions like, what is exactly algorithmic fairness? And what does that mean in the various digital domains? And, you know, a question that you just saw in one of the fields, what is really responsible digital science or data science? So those are the kind of more abstract, but certainly more overarching value questions that we as researchers are very much interested in. Now, just last month, and I wanted to make sure that you have noticed it, I think it was actually 3 weeks ago, Tim Berners-Lee, he launched a, what he called a Magna Carta for the World Wide Web. And basically what he has been showing is, you know, if we all have to commit to a core set of principles. And he has articulated some of these principles, which very much align with the principles that, you know, we've been working on in our book and that I think will be discussed here this afternoon. And interestingly, he caters his principles towards the three types of stakeholders that I just mentioned. He talks about what should governments do to make this responsible world of, you know, digital world happen. He alludes to companies. How can companies make the internet accessible to everyone? And what can citizens do? You know, you and I as citizens, what can we do to be creators and collaborators on the web? So I think this is an important and interesting core set of principles that ask us to cement basically public values in platform systems as we use them. If they're not cemented or not implemented in the infrastructure themselves, we have to negotiate those values in the institutions that implement them. So, you know, this I think is very important if we want to develop a responsible digital society. Tim Berners-Lee articulated this manifest, hey, we're all responsible for this, making this digital society a better place. You know, we consumers, citizens, entrepreneurs, government, corporations, we're all stakeholders that need to invest in making this digital societies work. All the problems that I showed in the beginning, I think they're a tremendous challenge for us to solve them. I don't think we can solve them here in this room with this number of people, but I think our country, the Netherlands, and all of our combined universities have made a brilliant start to work on these problems together. And I think, you know, we have, especially researchers, have a special role to play in bringing stakeholders together. And I think that's why we are here today. So thank you very much for listening.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Jose. Now, I can imagine you would love to continue a discussion with Jose. And we have the opportunity for that, but not in this plenary. So Jose will be with us throughout the afternoon, in the breaks, in the different workshops. So she said, please approach me if you want to continue to talk about this, if you have any specific questions. But for you, it's time to go out there. It's time to go out there and be curious. It's time to go out there to start making those new connections. So we're going to close our first plenary in a moment, and we're going to start the first of two parallel rounds, workshop rounds. If you look around you, you see these little white beach flags, which indicate where the breakout rooms of your workshop is. When you came in, you received the badge. Either on the back of it, it lists which workshop you're intended to go, or you have received a little piece of paper which lists where you go. So first round starts at 2 o'clock, it takes 50 minutes, then we have a short 20-minute coffee break, we have a second round of 50 minutes, and I hope to see you all back here, all enlightened and connected, around 4:15 for a closing plenary with a very special guest. Have a good afternoon.